You know, it sometimes frustrates me when I hear about this, we have to shift left and that developers really need to be in charge of operations and that's what DevOps is. And it could be farther from the truth. The whole point of what DevOps is supposed to be is developers and operations getting together to release better quality software in less time. And, you know, from an IT ops perspective, it's surprising to me how many people feel threatened as they hear about DevOps when they really should be embracing this. And quite frankly, as administrators, we really could learn from some of the processes that developers are using on an ongoing basis. Things like source control and, you know, really the everything as code. We should really be able to deploy our infrastructure as code and our configuration as code and find better ways to automate this stuff so we really truly can have a reproducible and effective cloud environment that meets everyone's needs. Now, in Azure, we have a wicked set of tools that can help with this, and I think it's IT ops responsibility, us as administrators, to really learn how to use them. So I want to show you something called Azure DevOps and how you can use it in your IT ops to really master the Microsoft Cloud. Dean Epp here. Welcome to the channel designed for aspiring Azure administrators like you and me who want to know ops and, well, master the Microsoft Cloud. I'm so happy to have you here. Thanks for coming by. Now, when I'm talking about Azure DevOps, I want to take a step back to talk about the purpose of what DevOps really should be and how we can leverage this in Azure as administrators. You know, when I think about it, there really is two things in Azure as administrators that we need to be really good at. One is being able to detect and control configuration drift, because it is so easy through the Azure CLI or through the portal to have team members to make changes without us understanding what's going on, which could positively or negatively impact our cloud environments. The second thing would be about idempotence, or the ability to make sure that things can be built out, rolled out, managed the same way each and every time. And I think that that's a skill that not a lot of people are always following up on and learning and improving. So you think about it for a second. You can very easily just go into the Azure portal, go into the marketplace, select some resources and spin them up. You can do that. And maybe it'll take you weeks to tweak it, set it up and get it where you need to. But then what happens when the engineering group says, hey, I need a dev environment to test some changes? Can you really afford to take 2 or 3 weeks to try to roll that out? Or how about worse yet, when the developers build out an environment and then you're responsible for rolling that into production and you don't understand the decisions and the reasons why they do it. Some developers are amazing at understanding operations, but a lot aren't. And so they don't think about the production considerations we need to think about for monitoring and managing and the whole idea of SRE and site reliability engineering and making sure we can keep these systems up and running. So the idea of using idempotency is the ability to say, I can create that environment very, very quickly to match exactly what's in the other one, obviously configured for the environment we need to accomplish. So this is where things like infrastructure as code, configuration as code, and even documentation as code can be very powerful. The ability to be able to, via script, to be able to deploy an environment. Now, in many other episodes, I've showed you how to use things like the Azure CLI to make it much easier to codify or execute and manage resources. And you can very easily create scripts to do that. And in fact, you'll actually hear a lot of people out there saying, you really should be doing it through scripts like that. But I don't think that's actually the case. What you really want to be doing is being able to template and architect in a way so that you can describe what your environment is and then allow the cloud system, the platform itself, to be able to take advantage of getting that deployed and configured for you. And this is where things like ARM templates can be so powerful. Azure Resource Manager is the backplane of pretty much every management task you do. So it doesn't matter if you're doing it through the portal, if you're doing it through the CLI, or if you're doing it through RESTful means. At the end of the day, it's gonna go through the ARM backplane for management. So things like ARM templates can really be helpful here. But the reality is, when you want to use things like ARM templates, how do you consistently manage and monitor that? Well, that's the power of being able to use things like Azure DevOps to create a pipeline that will allow you to deploy exactly the way you want to each and every time. And in many cases, it's done in a way so it's frictionless, so nobody has to actually touch it. This is where idempotency can really help, because now we can know if we run this process in this way, we can make these changes exactly the way we want to. As an example, you can make a configuration change to a JSON file or to a configuration file. And when you check that in, that could automatically execute a pipeline that could run that ARM template to update those resources in Azure exactly the way you want to. So now those changes are documented through source control. The execution of that change is actually tracked through the pipeline's logs. And ultimately, when that gets deployed out into the infrastructure, there's a set of log items in the activity history that allows you to be able to know what happened when and by whom. And that is a very powerful part. The other reason this is interesting is that it allows us to start rethinking what mean time to recovery really means. Honestly, in the cloud environment where it's so easy to make changes, I'm really not thinking we should be focusing on repairing items when we can just redeploy. In many cases, it can be much faster to do a redeploy than a repair in an environment where we may or may not be able to completely control it. Now, hey, maybe you're using Rhesus locks correctly. You're using the RBAC system correctly to be able to track these things, but things happen. People get involved. The more that you can automate this, the stronger it's gonna be. The last thing I'd talk about would be about thinking about how you plumb this out. When you're using Azure DevOps and you're using things like the CI/CD pipelines, you can very easily configure service principles to be able to deploy to production environments. This allows you to script the whole idea of removing a resource lock, applying these changes, and then reapplying it without a human being involved. Or even better, you can then start using the workflow approval processes built right into Azure DevOps so that when changes need to occur, there can be a two-person approval process or a release management process that would help you to be able to make sure that everyone knows what's going on, when it's going on, and making sure that the right approvals are in place so that environments change only when they're supposed to. This is what's really interesting. So I encourage you to go check out Azure DevOps. Go to dev.azure.com. You can sign up and get a free account that'll allow you and up to five people in your team to be able to access the system, try it out, and see it for yourself. I think if we embrace Azure DevOps for things like infrastructure as code and configuration as code and even documentation as code, we as administrators can start following a lot of the best practices that developers have been following for years that can help to be able to build and deploy in a safer, more resilient manner. And I think Azure DevOps gives us that with things like Azure repos for our source control of our configuration files and any of our ARM templates or any other kind of configuration we might have for infrastructure as code. The fact that those check-ins can actually be documented so we know exactly what's going on, that's allowing us to use code as documentation, which is very powerful. And of course, the whole configuration in the Azure pipelines, when we're doing a CI/CD, we can actually set up a configuration so that it configures resources as it's being deployed or updated in a way so that developers don't ever need to know those configurations. And in many ways, from a security perspective, they don't have access to that. Using properly locked down service principles, we can ensure that through Azure DevOps, we can deploy to production while still allowing developers to have the control they need in the actual build out of the software that they're building. Hope that makes sense. And I really hope that this made sense for you and that you'll go give it a try. Let me know by hitting the like button. And if you haven't yet, smash the subscribe button so you can be notified as I release new videos each week. Until then, thanks for watching. We'll see you in the next episode.